Hello, hello guys. I am just doing an audio test. I think it sounds good. Just gonna wait to hear my own voice.
Hello, again. Hello guys.
Okay, there it is. Hi guys. Hello everybody in the chat. Hi, welcome. Oh my god, it's been a while. I get so nervous and then I like prepped so much for tonight. I think I did, but we know that something's gonna go wrong and I'm gonna fumble something. It'd be really awesome to have like some tech support. Support? Is that the word? Some tech help while I do this. A production team would be really fun, you know, but I'm not there yet. So I have to manage all of this by myself with all the graphics and making all the things, and the intros, and I have some awesome commercials today. And I see in the chat we have, am I saying your name right? Agata? Hi. So she's joining us today. She's kind of like a new gal in the scene here. So give her some welcomes in the chat. It's super fun. Everybody in the chat is really like intelligent. I say this all the time. I'm always flattering you guys in the chat. You guys are so smart. You guys are really fun. It's a really, really fun group of people that we have here. So, hey, Pablo. Hey. So give her some love, show her kind of what we're about in here. That'd be really awesome. And I'm trying to get my like energy up. I have some coffee here. I'm going to try not to say, sound like my, junior high school history teacher. She used to go, all the time, and now I realize I do that, and I'm like, okay, that's why she did that. It's really easy when you're just in front of a bunch of people rambling from your brain to just go, all the time. Anyway, I am trying to get really amped because I have been told that I'm really boring and low energy on camera. So, sorry about that. I'm not really a good speaker on camera. I am better at just going, ah. Oh, that's also a sound we hear on the stream a lot. You know, it's very descriptive. Very descriptive. Kind of like when Kami Mark was talking to me about my comic book and he was helping me with the edits. He was like, you know, all the parts that are very, ooh. That's how he described all the alchemy magic. Was with the sound. It was awesome. Anyway, now that I'm sitting here, I realize that it's very quiet. Well, not really quiet. I can hear cars in the back, and I might have to shut that window. But it's really awkward just talking out loud by yourself. I know that you guys are there, but I'm by myself. And not even Jack is home. So he is out on a business trip, and he will be out on a business trip throughout the weekend for a few days. So I am thinking that I should stream while I'm alone. It'll maybe keep me sane, and you know, what else is there to do? I don't have him to cook like four-course meals. Not really four-course, but fantastic meals for. So yeah, we may as well stream. I'll try to stream as many days as possible the next few days. Why not? Fuck it. You know what I mean? Okay, but yeah, speaking of Agata, I think that's how I say your name. I have some awesome... I have a new segment. And actually, Pablo, you may like this segment as well on this show because you helped inspire me with the aesthetics here. And you'll see what I mean by this. Because, yeah, you'll get it. When you see it, you're gonna laugh and go, holy shit, no way. Because, you know, sometimes I get inspiration from shit that we talk about in our Discord, and you'd be surprised how I pull shit out of my ass for some things. So, I don't know, we may as well just get to it now. We have some art history to go through, so let's see. We got this content stream. Okay. I'm gonna like review where we left off, and then I'm gonna get into the new segment. And the new segment is called Hardcore Video. Okay? And I'm going to be featuring a hardcore video. It's not porn, don't worry about it, but it is pretty hardcore. And I think that I asked I asked the band if I can show it on my stream, if it's a copyright issue. They said, go ahead, sure, spread it around. But the purpose of me showing this on stream is because I can post links, I can say, guys, check this out, and only a handful of people will actually click on a link to check something out. And now that I have the attention of a few people, maybe like, what, 2 dozen people? How many people are in here? Now that I have the attention of people, I may as well force the video on you so you can see how actually cool it is. And it's a segment called Hardcore Video, okay? But let's see where we are at right now. Hold on, hold on, hold on. Ah, I need help. Window capture. So, we are not here. No, that's not happening. So, we are in the chapter called Europe and America, 1870 to 1900. Oh, now I remember. Yes, the window is open, but it feels a bit awkward to just talk in silence. I need the piano music. Remember the piano music? I need piano in the background. So while I play the video, I'm going to look for the piano file. But anyway, so we are in the chapter of Europe and America, 1870 to 1900. And last time we went over this amazing, amazing piece, the Ophelia in the lake. I think it is. She's in a lake. Awesome. Love to recreate this in some photography sometime. That'd be really, really awesome. We do have lakes in New York. It's very green and lush. Oh, we could do this. We could do this. Agata, come hang out with me and let's do this. We'll photoshoot each other. Photoshoot each other. We'll shoot each other. We'll take photographs of each other. Photoshoot each other. I don't know. So, yeah, we were going over some of that stuff. Some realism is what we went over, and now we are still in Europe and America, 1870 to 1900, but we need to finish off the chapter with architecture. And that is going to have a few amazing things. The Houses of Parliament, the Paris Opera House. Is it called the Paris Opera House? Paris Opera, the Crystal Palace. And then we get into photography, which is interesting because this is the first time we dip our toes into some photography from the ancient art history, from cave paintings all the way up until this point. It has been some sort of paintings, drawings, lithographs, even etchings, architecture, sculptures, but now we are finally getting into photography, and it's actually a really interesting place because it completely changes the course of art. And this is when, you know, we have seen in the past art is, it wasn't really about like interpreting things and making things of what I feel like or just weird artsy-fartsy shit. It was actually a really, really serious study, and it was funded by, we've seen emperors, kings, all sorts of people, the Pope fund artwork, and it was used as a tool to influence the masses or to depict what was going on in society. It was portraiture. It was basically photography because we didn't have photography, so it was a way for people to document things, and that's why art and history go hand in hand a lot of times. It was documentation of what was going on in the world. But then photography comes along and it's like, well, we don't need people to paint shit anymore. I can take a photograph of stuff. We can document with photography. We can take portraits with photography. So it kind of changes the course of art because then it becomes a little bit more about self-expression, and that's where Impressionism. That's when Impressionism starts to happen. So anyway, it's exciting. We'll get into some photography and the types of photography, and we'll do a recap of what the chapter is about since I haven't done this in a few months. We need to kind of revisit what the rest of the chapter was about. And it's kind of short today, I think, because I realized that I ended up going for like 3 hours or something crazy because like I want to have a nice big chunk segment of stuff, and it often is too much. So I figure we'll wrap this up really nicely. If it's too short, whatever, I don't care. We'll start a new chapter tomorrow. I'm probably going to babble like I am now, and God knows how long that has been going on. I have some commercials that are a bit long. But, you know, I'll be hanging out in the chat, so don't leave when there's a commercial. So, chill, chill. Let me get back. Oh my God, of course I have to fix things. I didn't do Streamlabs. I didn't. There's always something to do. I gotta reset my Streamlabs goal because that is like months old. But if you enjoy the stream and you want to help me out and, you know, let's just, we want to keep this going. Let's donate to streamlabs.com/MartinaMarcotaTV. You could always do various things as well, PayPal or Super Chats or whatever. But this is always really good because it goes to me directly and they don't take a third of it like YouTube does. So anyway, we have Mr. Pulp Noir with the dollars. Thank you so much, Pulp Noir. I got to figure out how to get these widgets going. Anyway, let's see. Is it your first time watching the art streams, Mr. Pulp Noir? Okay, okay. Pablo says the photography ruined everything. Yeah. Yeah, hyper-realist artists panicked when photography started coming about. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Which is really funny because we went from the chapter of realism to photography. So they started to get super hyper-realistic and then suddenly photography came. They're all like, well, fuck. Cool. Okay, so let's get into the segment called Hardcore Video, and I just want to promote this band. I gotta put it in the links and all the information into the description, but if anybody in here wants to pop links in the chat right now, we can do that, and by the end of the stream I'll put it in the description. But I just wanted to promote a friend's band, and I'll chat about it afterwards. Hold on, let me find it. Hardcore Video. All right, check this out. I like it and I want to share it with you guys. Get to know them. Holy fuck, I fucked it up. Let me do it again. Sorry, just bear with me. Fuck. I fucked it up. We'll be right back. But then I heard this one, and I can't stop listening to this version of it. It's just, like, has that, like, I like it. And my husband didn't even know the original version, and he was like, I like theirs better. Which is really saying something, because it's a classic. I think it's a classic rock song. Yeah, it's really good. So I feel like they need some views, they need support, they need subscribers. Like, they should be seen. It's really, really good. I mean, the music video is really done really well, and the song is great. Like, they just, and they have the vibe. It's really, really good. So I just want to, like, force the video in front of people, and not just post links and say, watch, watch, watch. So, okay, that was that segment. Let's get into the art history. And I found the piano music. Let me know if it's okay. Because I remember one time I was like, trying to play the piano music, but I made adjustments to my mic, which was like kind of canceling it out and making really weird sounds. So let me know if it's okay. I hope I don't get a copyright strike. Sometimes, like, I think this should be copyright free. Sometimes they, like, freak out, and it's like, really? One time my roommate, when I had a roommate, had, like, was playing something in another room, and it was picking up, or the bar outside, and the music, and the YouTube picked it up, and I was like, are you fucking kidding me? So. Let's get started. Reading skills. So, we are starting with architecture. In architecture, the 19th century brought not only the revival of many earlier styles, including the Gothic, the Classical, and the Baroque, love it, but also the introduction of new building materials that would have an important future in design and construction. So they brought in the 19th century a revival of earlier styles, but new materials to use. Cool. And an example of this is the Houses of Parliament. Okay, let's get the art up. Oh my god, it's always something. Let me get the art up, hold on. Art history. No, I thought I had all the files up. Where are they? Okay, there they are. There we go. Houses of Parliament, people. We made it. So, England celebrated its medieval heritage with neo-Gothic buildings. In London, after the old Houses of Parliament burned in 1834, damn, I didn't know that it originally burnt, but I hope I'm saying this guy's name correctly, A.W.N. Pugin? Pugin. P-U-G-I-N. Pugin? Pugin. 1812 to 1852, submitted the writing design for the new building. Sorry, I was just looking because it says figure 1223, and I want to make sure. I was like, that's not a writing design. That's a picture of it. Okay. So yeah, he submitted this winning design for the new building. By this time, style had become a matter of selection from the historical past. Barry had traveled widely. Oh, sorry. Old Houses of Parliament had burned, and then in 1834, Charles Barry, 1795 to 1860, with the assistance of A.W.N. Pugin, submitted the writing design for the new building. By this time, style had become a matter of selection from the historical past. Barry had traveled widely in Europe, Greece, Turkey, Egypt, and Palestine, studying the architecture of each place. He preferred the classical Renaissance styles, but he had designed some earlier neo-Gothic buildings, and Pugin successfully influenced him in the direction of English late Gothic. So cool. And I mean, I've seen the Houses of Parliament in person. It has that really Gothic vibe, very ornate, really, really cool. I'm going to show you a bunch of other various pictures as well. Let me see. I'll just zoom in on this a little bit. As well. How do I do that? Can I zoom in? Oh lord. Nope. Okay. That's being. What happened? Whatever. It's being a bitch. This is it during like dusk, and it's along the water there. I think that's Westminster? Oh my god. The bridge by Parliament is really hilarious because I should have saved the pictures of it for you guys. But when the sun hits through it and there's like the gaps in the bridge and it creates a shadow on the ground, it looks like a shadow of a penis. It's really funny. But yeah, here's some of the ornate design you can see. It's like spiky little spikes. Really cool. Is that like the courtyard or something? I don't think I've ever seen that. You can see the Gothic influence here. And yes, that is Big Ben. Lets it lit up at night. Awesome. I mean, you can just see the influence of the Gothic. That's inside. Houses of Parliament. This is where the politicians do their thing. How cool is that? They start yelling at each other there. It's really cool. They start yelling at each other, yeah. Let's go back to this picture.
So where was I? Pugin was one of a group of English artists and critics who saw moral purity and spiritual authenticity in the religious architecture of the Middle Ages. I mean, that is really, really cool. I want to say that again. Pugin was one of a group of English artists and critics who saw moral purity of the Middle Ages. They also glorified the careful medieval artisans who built the great cathedrals. The Industrial Revolution was flooded. The Industrial Revolution was flooding the market with cheaply made and ill-designed commodities, and machine work was replacing handicraft. Pugin believed in the necessity of restoring the old artisanship, which had honesty and quality. Oh my god, I fucking love that. Yeah, the Industrial Revolution and its consequences, says Eduardo. That's right. Yeah, I mean, I totally agree with that. I mean, you know, machinery is really useful. It can pump things out in high quantities. It's a marvel. Machinery is a marvel. But handicraft, there's really, this definitely some sort of purity to it, as they say. And there's quality to it, for sure. Yeah, I don't know. It's great. The design of the Houses of Parliament, however, is not genuinely Gothic. Duh, it's neo-Gothic. Despite its picturesque tower groupings, the Clock Tower, containing Big Ben at one end, and the Victoria Tower at the other. The building has a formal axial plan and a kind of palatial regularity beneath its neo-Gothic detail. Really cool. I am just going to update the Streamlabs real quick. God, I hope I don't get copyright with this music. But yeah, talk amongst yourselves about the Houses of Parliament, because we're going to move on after that. Mm-mm-mm. Okay, let's end this goal, and we are going to do... What is this week? Let's do art history. All right, boom, new goal. Be able to see your guys's BMT lines. Hi, says I really enjoy your art history streams. Thank you so much. Really appreciate that. Was supposed to be a widget that didn't happen, so let's see. Why Streamlabs not updating? It's supposed to update, motherfucker. Oh my god, it's always something. God, people probably think I'm so terrible at this. Update. I don't know how to do it. I'm gonna have to figure it out after the stream. But this is not right. I did not reach this goal. There's $6 that we've got so far. I don't know what's wrong with it. Thursday art history. I'll try it again. Mm-hmm.
Why doesn't anything ever work? I hate technology. Must be in the future. It is in the future. 5, 6. May 6th. What the fuck is this on about? Okay, there we go. Did it do it? It didn't do it. I don't understand why this won't change. I fucking hate technology. Ugh. I'm gonna fucking turn the thing off. Stupid. Technology. I don't know why, like, Streamlabs and shit has to, like, change the way that they do things. It's like, I go away for a few months, I come back, it's like, what the fuck? I learned how to use you, and now you changed everything. I don't know why you changed it. Oh my god, okay. I hate technology so much. The next one is the Paris Opera House. So, this is the 19th century brought the revival of many architectural styles. For Paris's opera house, Garnier. It's G-A-R-N-I-E-R. Like, I'm saying it like how the hair dye spell, like, says it, right? Garnier Fructis, right? That's what it is. Anyway, he chose a spectacularly theatrical neo-baroque facade with wings resembling doomed central plan churches. Yeah, I mean, this is... I wanted to do Houses of Parliament just because, like, my husband's British, I've seen Parliament, I've lived in England for a few years, let's represent, but it was very difficult to kind of get a cool picture of it for the thumbnail. But man, there's something about this Paris Opera House that looks so beautiful, and that is what the thumbnail that I chose was. So, so nice. Like, look at this, man. Ugh. So cool. Actually, I want to see if I can bring this up a different way for you guys. Yes, come on. That's not it. That's not it. That's not it. Fuck it. I can't do it. I don't know. Why wouldn't it go back? Oh my god. I just want to cry. I just want to continue streaming about art history. Let's go. Come on. Let's go. Show what is on my screen. There we go. So, in contrast for the Paris... In contrast from the Houses of Parliament, for the Paris Opera House, Charles Garnier, 1825 to 1898, designed a festive and spectacularly theatrical neo-baroque neo-Baroque facade with two wings resembling domed central plan churches. Inside, intricate arrangements of corridors, vestibules, stairways, balconies, alcoves, entrances, and exits facilitate easy passage throughout the building and provide space for entertainment and socializing at intermissions. Oh, I love theater. The Baroque grandeur? I hate saying this word because it reads really weird. It's spelled funny, so it makes me sound it out like really ridiculous, but it's very grand. The grandness of the Baroque layout of the opera house's decorative appointments and characteristic of an architectural style called Beaux-Arts. Oh, yeah. So Beaux-Arts is basically fine. It means fine art in France, and there was like a school that they studied Beaux-Arts, and it's a type of architecture. And in fact, in New York City, Grand Central Station is in the Beaux-Arts style, and so was the old Penn Station, was in the Beaux-Arts style, but then they like tore it down sadly and built up the monstrosity that is Madison Square Garden. Yeah, but the Beaux-Arts, it flourished in the late 19th and early 20th centuries in France, based on ideas taught at the dominant École des Beaux-Arts, School of Fine Arts, it literally translates to fine art, in Paris. Am I saying it right? I don't even know if I'm saying it right. I only know how to read things. It's the same thing with like alchemy and magic. Like I read things, I'm like, I don't know if I'm saying this right. The Beaux-Arts style incorporated classical principles such as symmetry and design, including interior spaces that extended radially from a central core or axis, and featured extensive exterior ornamentation. As an example of Beaux-Arts building, Garnier's Opera House Opera proclaims through its majesty and opulence its function as a gathering place for glittering audiences in an age of conspicuous wealth. So this was actually really popular, yeah, during the 19th century, but there was a point, which is why when they tore down the old Penn Station and they built the new Penn Station, which is really, it's shit, and not that I dislike modern or anything like that, like mid-century modern stuff. I actually really, really like it, but it just wasn't done well. And there was like a time period after the Beaux-Arts was in fashion. After that, it became in America like really out of fashion to do this opulence because it was associated to grand wealth. And I don't know what it was, if it was like war or like something that just made, I don't know, like just trying to separate ourselves as Americans or something, that like we really hated this opulence and it like became out of fashion. And it was just a sign of kind of like how the left like hates just like when it's like Elon, it's like, oh, he's so rich and how bad and evil it is to be wealthy and how dare you have opulence or anything. It was kind of that was the fad. It was like, we don't like opulence anymore. But anyway, as a performer, as a theater performer, stunning. I wish I could zoom in for you guys, but I don't know how to use technology, so unfortunately, I can't show you the details like I normally do on stream. I gotta get back into dealing with this bullshit. All right, there's a full screen picture for you. If there's anything else about me, well, this is the picture that I used for my thumbnail, but if there's anything that you know about me, I love ceilings. I am a ceiling gal. And that is some ceiling for you. Let me just check in on you guys real quick while you stare at that ceiling. Stunning. See what you guys are saying. Any comments or anything? I can't tell if I've had a super chat or something. Just let me know. Yes, Jay, Madison Square Garden. Pop Noir says it was self-hating hippies that hated America after the Vietnam War.
Yeah, I'm trying to think when it became out of style to do the view arts thing, but yeah.
Eduardo says, I fucking hate technology. Don't know if that came out of Martina Marcota or Ted Kaczynski. Yeah. I'm sorry, Eduardo, that I'm streaming while you're going to bed. Ah, BMT Line says, the story is complicated, but the short version is that the owners of Penn Station were nearly bankrupt at the time. How is that even possible? I mean, you own one of the main transportation stuff, but whatever. I do know that it was also difficult to expensive to maintain, they said, and so they were like, we can't maintain this shit. May as well tear it down and build something a little bit more sustainable up there, but it ended up being a terrible eyesore. It was not well done, and in the style that was the time. Okay, get back into it. But yeah, this Paris Opera House, oh my god, how stunning. I can't get over it. I love theater. Oh, look at it. I was like looking at this picture and I was thinking that I'm assuming that used to have real candles on those at one point, which is awesome. I guess that's why things burnt down all the time. But that is just ceilings. Ugh, glowing light. Stunning. Staircases, that's what they're talking about. Vestibules, staircases, places for intermission. Enclaves, is that what they said? Ugh. To perform in such a place, how amazing. I mean, I performed at some cool theaters, I'm not gonna lie. New York has some really, really cool architecture, yeah. And we have some old school theater looking things. Beautiful, beautiful. This is the outside, so that's what they were talking about, I think, like wings. Unless they were talking about like wings, like halls and stuff, but yeah, they got angels and shit. Got the copper with the patina on there. Very nice. Very nice. Oh! Stage. So beautiful. Look at the draped velvet. Mmm. The balconies. Fuck, man. See, I wanted to, like, film my new magic act in a theater, which we have. I mean, I'm not gonna compare it to the Paris Opera House, obviously, but we have. Excuse me, kitty. Come here. We have some really lovely, I'm not gonna lie, some really lovely theaters and stuff in New York. Upstate, all sorts of stuff. It's really, really lovely. Some old theater looking things, Martina Marcota 2020. Alright, let's move on to the next one. Then we have the Crystal Palace. Yeah. Let's get you guys on that. So, work on Garnier's Opera House began in 1861, but by then many architects had already abandoned sentimental and romantic designs from the past. Huh. Yeah. I'm just thinking about that because I'm trying to figure out the time frame of, yeah, like these, the Beaux Arts. I don't know if I'm saying it right. When it began to become out of fashion, and it was surprisingly early. So I'm trying to think about 1861. Anyway, yeah, so it became... many architects had already abandoned sentimental and romantic designs from the past. So they turned instead to honest expression of a building's purpose. I mean, that's really getting into modern. And this is what people don't understand, that modern art is actually a time period that did begin in, I think, the late 1800s. And went up to like 60s or 70s or something. So a lot of the times people confuse contemporary with modern, but you'd be surprised, modern started in the late 1800s. So it's crazy how they started to really focus in on purpose, sleek design, things like that. Like I said, the Beaux Arts and all that ornate things became out of fashion. So since the 18th century, bridges had been built of cast iron and most other utilitarian architecture, factories, warehouses, dockyard structures, mills, and the like, long had been built simply and without historical ornamentation. Iron, along with other industrial materials, permitted engineering advancements in the construction of larger, stronger, and more fire-resistant structures than before. The tensile strength of iron. That's an interesting word. Am I saying that right? Well, I like learning new definitions when we get here. Vocabulary words. Tensile. It's a strength. Let's see.
Tensile.
Sounds like tinsel, which is not very strong, but okay. It's related to tension. Tensile force. Capable of being drawn out or stretched. Okay. Interesting. New vocab word. So anyway, the tensile strength of iron, and especially of steel, available after 1860, permitted architects to create new designs involving vast enclosed spaces, as in the great train sheds of railroad stations and in exposition halls. Joseph Paxton, 1801 to 1865, had built several conservatories, greenhouses, on the country estate of the Duke of Devonshire. So we're in England. We're back in England now. We went from the Houses of Parliament in England to France with the Paris Opera House, and now we're back to England here with this Crystal Palace. Ooh, I'm getting hungry. Is that a Discord sound? I don't know where you are, Discord sound, but don't do that too often, guys. I don't know what Discord sound, where that came from. I have so many goddamn tabs and things open. I can't handle it. I need like a tech person. It's so frustrating. I just get like panicked and I'll start clicking on things and then fuck everything up. Turn of the 20th century threw out so many quality styles and artists. Art Deco and Federalist was the last great styles in architecture, in my opinion. You know, I find it interesting. I did do a stream a few years ago about Art Deco and maybe Brutalism too, or what is it called? Not Brutalist, but Dadaism and all that. And I actually think that Brutalism and Art Deco and Futurism are kind of similar. Like, they use concrete and glass and sharp, like, structures and really kind of rigid-looking, strong feelings. Except Art Deco has a little bit more ornateness to it, but it has the same vibe to me, which I think is really interesting. I actually don't hate Brutalism. When it's done well and it's done artistically with a really good architect or designer, or artist, I think it's really, really beautiful and really powerful. I feel like even the Nazis had a very brutalist, kind of strong aesthetic vibe when they built things. But yeah, I don't necessarily hate it, but I do hate it when it becomes like Soviet housing for like cheap housing, or even in America, the cheap housing blocks, or elsewhere in Europe or something. When it's done cheaply and for poor housing, it's really depressing. I don't like that. Get back to this. What are we looking at here? My cat is here. I wish you could see her. She's a little bitch when I try to pick her up, but yeah. She's sitting next to me. She likes to hang out. She doesn't like to be held, though. You want to sit on me, kitty? Yeah, she's very talkative. Trembling Colors says, brutalism, in my opinion, is a great style for villains or sci-fi dystopia. I agree. I definitely agree with that. Okay. So we have the Crystal Palace here. Oh my god, I got cat hair, like, molting on my face. Ah! I can feel cat hairs on my face. It's so annoying. Soviet architecture was meant to demoralize the population. I mean, some of it can be good. Like I said, even their, like, posters and stuff, it had this futurism, which futurism, brutalism, same thing. Like, it looks really similar. I don't really know the distinctions. But, I mean, push towards the future. That's what, you know, communists and stuff like to do, and socialists like to do, to push towards the future. And it like had some grandness to it, and I see what they were going for, but when it comes to cheap Soviet housing blocks, not so much. I don't think they gave a shit. Again, it's the designer and it's the intent behind it. I mean, even if you wanted to do something with the style, in the style of anything, even if it's like Gothic or whatever, if it's done kind of shitty, you can kind of tell, and it looks like, have you ever gone to one of these like tourist places? In America, we tend to do this. We have these like kind of like a Vegas. I've never been to Vegas, but like these touristy places that have like a fake, you know, Eiffel Tower, like a fake something. It just like has that cheap kind of shit feel to it. But doing that with like brutalism is even worse. You like don't have any good design, like aesthetic, and you're just like, yeah, big concrete slab, let's go for it. Ugh, no, not good. If you have a really good designer doing it, it'd be really interesting, cool. Like they do something cool with it. I love it. But speaking of Art Deco and stuff too, New York City is a very Art Deco city. If you walk around, you'll see a lot of buildings with the Art Deco, and we have the Beaux Arts thing. We have some modern, sleek things, some brutalist things. Albany has some brutalist type architecture that's actually kind of cool. I think Poughkeepsie might have some as well, but Albany has some really... I gotta show you this, these groupings of buildings in Albany. It's kind of crazy. Whenever I see it, I'm like, it's actually really badass. I'd love to do a photo shoot there. It's very strong, brutalist. Reminds me, I could do like a Helmut Newton type shoot there. It'd be really cool. That really strong... aggressive vibe. But what is it, the Chrysler Building and the Empire State Building, very Art Deco. And when you walk around, there's a lot of other, but I think like Rockefeller Center area has a lot of little ornate Art Deco-y things, and you can see in the gold. And sometimes I'll walk by buildings and I'll tell Jack, like, wow, look at how Art Deco that is. You can see the windows, you can see the entryways and things about the building. Very Art Deco in New York. So this is Joseph Paxton, Crystal Palace, London, England, 1850 to 1851. Enlarged and relocated at Sydenham, England, 1852 to 1854. Detail of a color lithograph by Archille Louise Martinet. Circa 1862, and it's a private collection. Thank you so much, Michael Kolchinski, for the super chat. I really, really appreciate it. I really wish that the Streamlabs thing was working properly. I gotta sort out the tech. You know what? Let me make a note of it, of all these issues that I always think that I'm sorted and everything's good. But then next thing you know, I'm live and there's something I didn't do right and I can't figure it out live on stream because I feel like I have to talk. Okay, so we have Stream Labs, Super Chats, Widgets, and the Goal. I need to update all that. I really appreciate it. Thank you. Said, hey lady, miss your face. Hope you're well. Aw, man. You and Barb are always really, really sweet. Thank you, Barb Rogers, Little Miss Sunshine, for the five... Is that Canadian dollars? I don't remember you being Canadian. Interesting. Yeah, both of you guys have been around for years, and I really appreciate you. I love our chat so much. We always have a really good time, and you're always so supportive and loving. Thank you. It's nice to be back. I get a little flustered and frustrated because of my lack of technical abilities, but when things are rolling, it's really nice to be a part of this thing again. And I think it's really important, which is something I always say, that art, culture, and learning, educational things, I think is really what it's about. I think we need... Little Miss Sunburn? Is that what it is? Is it Little Miss Sunburn? I always thought it was Little Miss Sunshine. It's just the movie, maybe. But, yeah, I think art, culture, education, these sorts of things are really important. There's a lot of drama on the internet. There's a lot of drama on YouTube. And don't get me wrong, it's fun, I understand, but gossip is like an addiction. It's a poison, and that's why they say it's a sin, but I understand why it's like, that's why tabloids and everything is really lucrative. It's always really entertaining. I mean, I will not get like 1,000 viewers in the chat, but the 30 or so that I get are really awesome. We're on the right track of learning and wanting better for ourselves and our society, and I think that's what it's about. If you are into politics, I think that's what we need to be at, is pushing forward with learning, and the importance of art and cultures, it needs to be not taken for granted. When things are rocking and rolling, that's right, Jay. Okay. Let's get back to it. So the tensile strength of iron permitted Paxton to experiment with a new system of glass and metal roof construction. Built with prefabricated parts, the vast crystal palace required only 6 months to erect. Wow, 6 months. Wow. It's much quicker than some people can draw a comic book. Interesting. Joseph Paxton, 1801 to 1865, had built several conservatories, greenhouses, on the country estate of the Duke of Devonshire. In the largest, 300 feet long, he used an experimental system of glass and metal roof construction. Encouraged by the success of this building technique, Paxton submitted the winning glass and iron design for the competition for the hall to the house. For the hall to house the Great Exhibition of 1851 in London. Paxton's hall, called the Crystal Palace, was the centerpiece of this exhibition, organized to gather together works of industry of all nations. Okay. Constructed using prefabricated parts, the vast structure was erected in the then unheard of time of 6 months and dismantled at the exhibition's closing to avoid permanent obstruction of the park. What? The plan borrowed much from the ancient Roman and Christian basilicas, with a central flat-roofed nave and a barrel-vaulted crossing transept. The design provided ample interior space to contain displays of huge machines as well as to accommodate decorative touches in the form of large working fountains and giant trees. The public admired the building so much that the workers who dismantled it erected an enlarged version of the Crystal Palace at a new location on the outskirts of London, where it remained until fire destroyed it in 1936. Yeah, so that's kind of where I'm at, because I was trying to get a little bit more photos of things to show you guys, and so just by the nature of looking up some photos and having my British husband working behind me at his desk, I was like, is the Crystal Palace real? Like, is this thing legit? And he was like, yeah, it burnt down. So I have some photos and videos for you to look at this. But that's why reading this, I was kind of like, what? Because they erected it in 6 months and then they disassembled it. So I guess it wasn't meant to be a permanent structure at this one location, but then they like put it back up somewhere else, which is wild. And it was there until it burnt down. Wild. So let's look at some of these photos. Okay, so this is the fire. You can see the blazing fire going on here. The fire happened in the 30s. So, yeah. That's why it's in black and white. Here's pictures of the Crystal Palace. Look at that. So cool. Okay, here's some art design of it. I mean, that's, I can't believe that was made in the 1800s. And, you know, a lot of conservatives will complain how, oh, glass structures, modern design, it's so terrible and hideous, but like, look, they were doing fucking glass buildings in 1800s. Like, look at that. And you could see the, in this art, the kind of Victorian looking outfits that these people have on. That's pretty amazing. They did, however, use traditional design. Like, when I was reading, it was talking about the floor plans, is it the central floor plan? The nave and the transepts, the barrel vaulted crossing transepts. So it kind of had that old school cathedral vibe with the, it's like a crossing and everything. Look at, this is an actual picture. Insane. You're telling me this is 6 months. Oh my god, some people can't get a comic book out. So cool. Yeah, so this is what they were talking about, where it was like housing, like, fountains and trees and, like, machinery things. Cool. Let me just make sure you guys can see it. Yeah, you got it. Okay, so here's an article. I kind of wanted to go over it with you just because I found it interesting and I thought that maybe it would be cool to go over with you guys. But London's Farewell to the Crystal Palace Archive, 1936. December 1st, 1936, crowds flocked to South London to watch flames devour the vast glass house, which had stood on Sydenham Hill for 82 years. Damn. There was no mistaking the earnestness of London's farewell to the Crystal Palace tonight. Wow, is this really a 1936 archive? Cool. The news was given out in one of the earlier news bulletins on the wireless. But long before that, the flickering orange glow in the sky, which could be seen from Islington? Willesden? Some of these British names are ridiculous. And even farther north and as far south as Hayward's Heath had begun to draw the crowds of hundreds of thousands by bus and car and train. By 9 o'clock, 3/4 of an hour after the fire had started, it was almost impossible to get within 1/2 mile of the palace. Fire engines had been called out from all over London. Cars and taxis stood jammed in the side streets roundabout the palace. Sorry. It was like the gathering of the crowd for one of the palace's old cup finals. Okay. Men and women and children tripped and stumbled over the miles of wriggling hose pipes, slopped about in the muddy streets, and pressed forward closer to the roaring blaze, transcending even the most spectacular of Mr. Brock's famous benefits. Now and again, through the orange and glow, an airplane with its green and white lights would show itself almost as if touching the top of the famous towers and then be lost in the blue of the moonlit sky. A strange crowd. It was a strange crowd. Okay. It was a strange crowd which came out to see the end of a famous London landmark. There were the connoisseurs who, forearmed with a knowledge of local topography, took the train from Victoria to Gypsy Hill. Is that right? Gypsy Hill? And took up their position comparatively comfortably on the slopes to watch the fire with an almost uninterrupted view. For the most part, the others were content to take a train to the palace itself and struggle their way through the crowds. There were the sorts of young men and women to be seen at almost any kind of free entertainment in the streets. There were vast numbers of cyclists, both men and women. There were the local residents who spoke knowledgeably of the features of the palace architecture and that. There were youngish men and women with traces of Bloomsbury, Hampstead, and Chelsea in their clothes and speech, taking the whole affair very gravely. So, various people they could tell by their speech and clothing from all sorts of the London area or England area. And they were very upset. Hold on one second. But among these were to be seen many elderly men and women to whom the destruction of the palace meant the end of a chapter in their lives. They spoke to one another in reminiscence, memories of the great Handel festivals, of Sims Reeves, of Sir Michael Costa. Is he a coffee guy? Costa? Get it? Well, you know, this reminds me of the fire in Paris there. What is it? The Notre Dame. Because I was in England at the time working for an online media company, and I had to run off to Paris to capture it and got on a train and we went there. And I mean, it's crazy that this is an article from 1936, and I mean, I did something really similar in Paris, and we got on that train and we went there and I interviewed a bunch of locals, and they were also very gravely, and from young and old. I did the same documentation in Paris. It's wild. And I got to, and I knew, and I wanted to go. I said, my husband hates Paris, but I was like, we gotta go. This is a piece of history. Like, this is like a moment in history. So it's kind of wild to read this about a Crystal Palace. And I just like, I'm just kind of like, yeah, no, I get it. I get it. I've been there. I've been there. Anyway, let me get back to reading this article. One would hardly have been surprised to have overheard someone recall the appearance of the Berlioz, just as, like, there's so many references in here that I'm just like, I don't know what they're on about, and probably nobody else does either, unless it's a super British thing that they know about, or it was, like, a thing, time period that, like, just made sense. They, some, like, fucking Kardashians of the day. I don't know. Anyway. One would hardly have been surprised to have overheard someone recall the appearance of the Berlioz. Just as white-haired men remembered aloud the famous occasion when Dvorak was seen there weeping over the performance of one of his own oratorios, I don't know, whatever, at the South Tower. It was curiously silent, which gathered at the low-level railway station within a quarter of a mile from where the pagoda-like South Tower tilted against a background of deep orange flames, like some monstrous steamer in a giant's kitchen. Descriptive. How very eloquent. Clouds of steam poured from the ventilator. Sparks of a deep orange blew out from it now and again, sending a thrill through the crowds as they watched them flicker in the sharp night air and die. The middle distance glowed a deeper and deeper red. Now and then a dull thud could be heard. Clouds of sparks shot up against the blue of the sky, and then the fire died down again. But all eyes were still fixed on the South Tower, hedged in it as its base with roaring flame. I mean, it just reminds me reading this how they're just being descriptive, they're explaining what was going on at the time, but in no way were they trying to like propagandize this. And in today's time, it's crazy how everything becomes propaganda. Like they turn a fire. I mean, they didn't even describe how did it start? What happened? What's going on? How does fire start? Now they'd be ranting and raving and politics, and one side would take one side and the other side would take the other side. Anyway, we have the Brian Madigan. Hey, what's up? I gave $5 with an A in front of it. Is that Australian? A? What is A? $5 A. Just wanted to show a little support. You're the best. Oh, hardly the best, but thank you. I'm trying to get there. I think maybe one day we can get a smooth stream going at some point. I'm not fucking everything up. Let me see. Okay. A hopeless task. The firemen seemed to have had a hopeless task from the start, and soon after 8 o'clock, their energies were concentrated on keeping the flames from reaching the two great towers which rise above the neighboring villas, to a height of a couple of hundred feet. The people living in those houses were soon warned of their danger, if indeed they needed warning, and left with as much of... Speaking of fire, I have chills right now. Oh, shit. Fuck, man. I hope this isn't bent. My light, last time I tried using it, like, smoked when I turned it on, and it just gave, like, a buzz and a pop, and it's freaking me out. Shit, I hope this isn't bent. It was leaning up against us. Okay, it's fine, I think. This is my cover, by the way, that Dario made. Some original art right here. Yeah, I don't have that leaning on there. Shit, that light freaked me out. Okay, I'll unplug it in a minute. Like, it's not smoking right now, but it did just pop. And it scared, like, I got, like, it, like, scared me. Freaked the fuck out. Okay. What's going on in Discord? The firemen seemed to have had a hopeless task from the start, and soon after 8 o'clock, their energies were concentrated on keeping the flames from reaching the two great towers. People living in their house... If they needed a warning, and left with as much of their personal belongings as they could carry with them. For a quarter of a mile radius round the palace, these houses were in darkness, a black foreground against the flatness. It's so poetic, this fire. Okay, I'll unplug it. Just give me a second. You can help me get a new one, guys, if you go to streamlabs.com/MartinMarcotaTV. Shortly before midnight, the crowds were increased. Oop, I have not been updating you guys. Yes, I have. Okay, I lied. Shortly before midnight, the crowds were increased with carloads of police from all over London, and men and women in evening dresses on their way home from the theaters. Theater. But by this time, all that remained of the palace were twisted girders, and dying flames. From tonight, thousands of householders on the north side of the river will find themselves deprived of a familiar opening gambit of conversation when entertaining visitors. The new phrase perhaps will come a little hard at first. On fine days, we used to be able to see the Crystal Palace from here. But it ought at least to inspire recollection and reminiscence. How cute. Okay, so... so, let's... there's a video. You guys want to check out this video? Let's see if I can get...
to few people in a lifetime comes the chance of seeing such a gigantic...
this transatlantic accent, man. So cool.
...is the funeral pyre of the Crystal Palace, the proudest building of the last century, one of the few remaining links with Queen Victoria and Prince Albert. Built in 1851 in Hyde Park for the Great Exhibition, opened in royal state by the Queen and the Prince Consort, it was later transferred to its present site in what was then the rural outskirts of London. In 1913, it became the property of the nation, was used as a naval training school during the war, and reopened to the public by their Majesties King George and Queen Mary 16 years ago. It was once spoken of by Thackeray as a blazing arch of lucid glass, and that description was never truer than tonight. At about 8 o'clock, the fire started at the Sydenham end. Within 5 minutes, it was blazing. The palace firemen did what they could, but it was obviously hopeless, and all the might of London's firefighting equipment can do little more than delay the inevitable destruction. Everything is against them. Across the high ground, the wind blows freshly from the northwest, driving the flames before it. Firemen work unceasingly. Miles of hose are unreeled. Water towers go up. High-pressure pumps roar. But all in vain. The palace is doomed. As the great glow lights the evening sky, every available means of transport brings the watchers in their tens of thousands. And is it worth it? Flames roaring up 150 feet. Such heat that people in neighboring houses are unable to look out of their windows. Masses of molten glass pouring down continuously. Huge skeleton of ironwork twisting and falling. Hold your breath. For 85 years, the Crystal Palace has been a playground and a landmark of London. We mourn its loss.
Sad. Sad. Yeah, that's right, Mr. Pupnoir. The way that guy is speaking reminds me of old school cartoons. Yeah, you know what, Trembling Colors, it's really funny that you say that, because it's exactly what my husband said when I played this video when I was, like, prepping for the stream. And, I was like, well, we could. I was like, we could, let's just, like, deliver all the news like this. Like, I'll make, like, some sort of video and try to do that accent and talk really fast and deliver the news all straight and fast. I'd be really hilarious and put some sepia tones on that shit or black and white. Be amazing. I'm going to deliver all news like that. Even with the music in the background. Dun, dun, dun. And Jack was like, yeah, something about like a terrorist delivering the news like that for like a terrorist attack with the music and everything. I was like, oh my God, it's just stop. All right. Well, well, well. So we have accomplished the architecture section, finally. It's been slow and steady, but we just have a quick little other section to go through. I knew this would be long enough for us today, especially getting back into it. I'm like a hot mess, but I think I'm gonna put a commercial on. And do not go anywhere, guys. Please don't leave me. We have a lot more fun to be had. We're going to learn about photography. And like I said, that this is a really exciting time in this whole art history streaming thing that we have, because we are finally going to make a shift into photography, which changes art. It changes the history of art. So in this art history, we are going into a new place where it's actually kind of exciting. We did a lot of the old stuff, and we're going to start getting into after photography. Things are going to get weird. So let's do a little commercial. It's going to be about like 10-15 minutes, so just so you guys know. It's entertaining. You can feel free to sit here and watch. I'll be in the chat engaging with you, but don't log off. We have a whole other section to go through. Okay? Let me make sure I have the right thing happening. Okay. Don't go anywhere. We're going to take a break. Go to the bathroom, have your smoke, do whatever you gotta do. But stick with us here, okay?
Right after Animal House, Eric Estrada and Howard Hessman meet the Dream Girls.
Hi.
Of every man's fantasy.
I'll just knock you dead.
Morgan Fairchild, Linda Carter, Kathy Lee Crosby, Victoria Principal, and much, much more. They're the sexiest super ladies on the scene. They're the women who rate a 10 later tonight.
Appreciation of the Stylists of America, who work in lines, forms, and textures and colors to give to us beauty, charm, and elegance in the conveniences, comforts, and necessities of our daily living. As a tribute to men and women who design. Crafts of the American stylists, the things about us are made to express our own free spirits and desires for the colorful things that spell sheer fun. Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome back, guys. Hello, hello. Yeah, that was a Bauhaus ballet that was created in the 20s. There's a lot of, if you look that up, Bauhaus and ballet, you'll see a lot of pictures. It's from the 20s. Really avant-garde, really, really cool. I think the film was filmed in the 70s, so, but there's a few different segments, so there's like, kind of like in real ballet, there's like portions, there's like different acts, and this is the first one. And I want you guys to see all of them because they're all really uniquely aesthetic, have their own coloring and vibe. They're really, really cool. And they get progressively weirder as it goes on, if you can imagine. But, yeah, so maybe we'll get to the second one by the end of this. Energy up with some late night coffee. So, where are we at now? Oh, look, I've sorted the Streamlabs out. Did a thing during the commercial. So, if you want to do streamlabs.com/martinmercadoTV, that will help me with my goal. Thank you. Sorting things out. Let's see where I'm at now. There we go. So now we are going into photography. And it says, ever since Frenchman Louise Jacques Mandet de Guerre, 1789 to 1851, and Briton William Henry Fox Talbot, 1800 to 1877, announced the first practical photographic process in 1839. People have celebrated photography as a revelation of visible things. The relative ease of the process, even in its earliest and most primitive form, seemed a dream come true for 19th century scientists and artists, who for centuries had grappled with less satisfying methods for capturing accurate images of their subjects. Photography also perfectly suited an age that saw artistic patronage continue to shift away from the elite few toward a broader base of support. The growing and increasingly powerful middle class embraced both the comprehensible images of the new medium and its lower cost. So that's interesting. It was a take that I didn't have, where it was like not only a shift in how we created art and our perspective on art and the importance of art. Aw, Seth, thank you so much. Thank you for the $40. Thank you. Thanks for the art and chill, Martina. Yeah, of course, man. This is really appreciate it. It means a lot. You guys are always really great in here, but this is what it's all about is art, culture, education. This is how we keep society flourishing. And you'll see in history throughout any culture in any time period, especially in the West, that when there was an emphasis on the importance of art and education and things like that is when they were the most prosperous. So if we really want to change society and have things become good times, it's less about bitching and complaining about the other side, which, don't get me wrong, I will do sometimes. I've been very frustrated specifically today about a certain topic involving politics, but it's more trying to steer everybody in the right direction and not really trying to bitch about politics, but just kind of like, hey guys, come on, this is not about sides here. It's about what's right. And ultimately, if our side wants to make a positive impact, it's about art, culture, and education. So, okay, let's get back to it. For the traditional artist, oh yeah, I was saying it's just interesting how this was not just a shift in art, but it was something that was used for the middle class that, like, benefited the middle class, and now things like portraiture or documenting things was available much cheaper for the middle class. That's really cool. For the traditional artist, photography suggests a new answers to the great debate about what is real and how to represent the real in art. It also challenged the place of traditional modes of pictorial representation originating in the Renaissance. Artists as diverse as Delacroix, Ingres, Courbet, and the Impressionist Edgar Degas welcomed photography as a helpful auxiliary to painting. They marveled at the ability of photography to translate three-dimensional objects onto a two-dimensional surface. Interesting. Other artists, however, saw photography as a mechanism capable of displacing the painstaking work of skilled painters dedicated to representing the optical truth of chosen subjects. Photography's challenge to painting, both historically and technologically, seemed to some artists an expropriation of the realistic image until the exclusive property of painting. Until then, the exclusive property of painting. So basically what I was saying, like, it used to be exclusively creating realistic imagery was, like, exclusively to painters, but then it was like, holy fuck, exactly, those quotes, holy fuck, photography changed things. It wasn't now exclusively to painters. Artists themselves were instrumental in the development of this new technology. The camera obscura was familiar to the 18th century artists. We saw that with Vermeer. With Vermeer, and I think Leonardo da Vinci was also really into the camera obscura kind of stuff. Noticed something. Any chance I could promote my upcoming campaign? Yeah, sure. We can, you know, if you're on my Twitter, message me and maybe we could even do a stream about it. So yeah, check it out. Okay. Artists themselves were instrumental in developing this new technology. The camera obscura was familiar to the 18th century artists. In 1807, the invention of the camera lucida, lighted room, replaced the enclosed chamber of the camera obscura. Now the photographer aimed a small prism lens hung on a stand downward at an object. The lens projected the image of the object onto a sheet of paper. It's kind of like one of those, like, projection things that we had in school. Artists using either of these devices found this process long and arduous, no matter how accurate the resulting work. All yearned for a more direct way to capture a subject's image. Two very different scientific inventions that accomplished this, the daguerreotype, and the calotype. They were announced almost simultaneously in France and England in 1839. That's interesting because calculus was also developed simultaneously, independently of each other, around the same time, but completely different. Isn't that wild? Yeah. So we have the daguerreotype. I think I'm saying it right. If I'm saying it wrong, let me know. I could do the pronouncenames.com. Yeah, we can go to that if you want. The French government presented the new daguerreotype process at the Academy of Science in Paris on January 7th, 1839, with the understanding that its details would be made available to all interested parties without charge. Wow, look at that. Although the inventor received a large annuity in appreciation. Soon, people worldwide were taking pictures with the daguerreotype camera in a process almost immediately christened photography. From the Greek photos, light, and graphos, writing. Light writing. Cool. Each daguerreotype is a unique work with amazing detail and finely graduated tones from black to white. Still life in studio, figure 1226 is one of the first successful plates daguerre produced after perfecting his method. Okay, let's check that out real quick. Hold on, give me a second to find where the art is. Which one are we looking at? 1226. Very cool. Looks like a still life. Hold on one second. There we go. Ugh, I wish I could zoom it in for you guys, though. How do I do this? Not fair. I'm gonna try again to see if I can get this other image for you so I can zoom in. Not a mirror. Desktop picture? No! That's not it. Damn it. Oh, oh, oh. Yes, I found it. Okay, cool. Hey! Nice to see you, dancer boy. Thanks for stopping by. He says, yes, art stream, just stopping by. Thank you, thank you. We're at the tail end of it, but, yeah, it was good. Some good stuff going on. Blake, LOL. That's right, Blake. Dancer boy. I'm fucking retarded, don't mind me. Everyone knows that. Alright, so this is like zoomed in a bit, but we're talking about photography. Is this the first photograph? I think this is the first photograph. This was his prototype. Let's see what it says here. Louise Jacques Mendes Daguerre. Daguerre? Daguerre. It's a still life in studio, 1837. This is 6 1/4 inches by 8 1/4 inches. It's a collection in France of photography in France. Yeah, I like the texture in this still too. This is why film photographs are just so cool. I'm all about film. Oh, speaking of photography, actually, it's funny that I have this stuff right around me. Behind me, I have this Polaroid camera. It's not vintage or anything, but it's a new Polaroid camera that I have. It's a mini. But it's film, and it has this cool kind of vintagey vibe to it. So that's exciting. I always love working with those. Oh my god, this is funny too, what I have here. This is back in the day. It's a really fucked up, messed up slide that I have from July 1997. And it's barely visible, but it's a picture of me at the beach in 1997. You see how it fucked up it got? I just found it at my mom's house one time. Let's see if you can see it. No, you can't. I need to shine a light behind it. Really. I don't know if you can see it. No, it doesn't help. It's fucked up, but you can still make things out. It's really interesting. Still, it's teenage me. But I also have this, which I kind of want to get some film for. The film, I mean, it's not expensive, like... In reality, it is expensive, but it's, I don't know, it might cost me like $40 to get like maybe 3 rolls or something, or 2 rolls, but I've had this laying around forever, and I'm just thinking, I have a bunch of other vintage cameras, and I'm just thinking, I want to start playing with it, because even the expired film, you can use expired film. It's from the 70s, this thing. And you could totally use it. It'll just, perhaps, maybe sometimes the pictures will have like this weird haziness or like color flares or something on it. And that's actually kind of a cool, fun effect. So it's, you know, as an artist, who cares? Why not, man? Like, get some cool expired film for this baby. It's really light. This thing is incredible. It's so goddamn light. But let me see. Yeah, man, see? You guys remember these things? Putting film in there. Push the thing back. And this lever is so cool. It's not even a button, it's like a lever. But yeah, that would be really cool to take pictures with. And it says this is the actual print size right here. Look at these 70s people. They're just chilling. Chilling with their denim. So that's fun. I have a bunch of other cameras too, but this one's kind of fun. I feel like that could take some really interesting pictures, artsy stuff, Polaroid, and I don't know, I got some other like 80s, 90s ones. Yeah, anyway, so back to this, but I really love film. I love shooting with. I would love to own a Hasselblad sometime. That is like my favorite camera. I've shot as a model with a Hasselblad plenty of times, and it's just really, really cool camera. And I had a girl follow me around to all my gigs in the 2010s when I was performing, and she would take film photographs of me backstage, on stage, just in between things, like getting on the subway, like all sorts of stuff. She would follow me to every gig, and it had this quality to it. It's really cool. They were black and whites, grainy. It was really, really cool. But yeah, this is one of the first plates Daguerre produced after Daguerre. I'm going to say Daguerre now. Produced after perfecting his new photographic process. In this still life, in which he was able to capture amazing detail and finely graduated tones from black to white. I mean, how cool is that? Imagine being there when you first saw this happening. You were like, what the fuck? Like, I just captured real life, dude. Crazy. That is probably amazing. So the French government I already read that. The process captured every detail, the subtle forms, the varied textures, the diverse tones of light and shadow, and Daguerre's carefully constructed tableau. The three-dimensional forms of these sculptures, the basket and the bits of cloth spring into high relief and are convincingly represented. The inspiration for the composition came from the 17th century Dutch still lives. Remember, those Dutch still lives? Love still lives. Such as those by Pieter Claes. Like Claes, Daguerre arranged his objects to reveal their textures and shapes clearly. Unlike a painter, Daguerre could not alter anything within his arrangement to effect a stronger image. However, he could suggest a symbolic meaning through his choice of objects, just like they did with the still lifes, like the oh my god, I'm thinking Muerte. It's the, what is it called? The Memento Mori. The Memento Mori. Yeah. They had a lot of symbolisms in the Memento Mori still lives. However, he could symbolic meaning through the choice of objects, like the skull and timepiece in Claes' painting, Daguerre's sculptural and architectural fragments, and the framed print of an embrace suggest that an suggests that even art is vanitas and will not endure forever. So yeah, just kind of like the memento mori, that things will not last forever. Sad but true. Yeah. Well, speaking of this first photograph, there's a little bit more about the daguerreo type. Let's figure out how to say that, actually.
Daguerreotype.
I like daguerreotype. Wow, I'm seeing more. Oh my god, I want to show this to you guys. Cool. Is this the dude and his camera? Come on. Let's see. I'm going to try to share this with you. Yes, here we go. Is this the fella, or maybe just a picture he took, but like really cool. Oh, look, it says daguerreotype on it. Daguerreotype. And look at the little shutter area. Very cool. I love the graininess of photography. Very cool. Love it. Look, veins on his hand. Very cool. Okay, let's bring it back to the other picture. So the earliest photographic processes were the daguerreotype, named after L.J.M. Daguerre, and the callotype. Daguerre was an architect and theatrical set painter and designer who created a popular entertainment called the diorama. Wow! It's Mr. Diorama over here. Remember doing that in school, guys? Oh, I love a good diorama. Oh, that is like I see why, like, a set designer, set painter and a designer created a diorama, concept of a diorama. I get that. That makes sense. It's very much like a set. Hello, George. Nice to see you. Thank you. Okay, so where are we? The diorama. Audiences witnessed performances of living paintings created by changing the lighting effects on a sandwich composed of a painted backdrop and several layers of painted translucent front curtains. Wait, hold on. I have to read this again. So audiences witnessed performances of living paintings created by changing the lighting effects on a sandwich composed of a painted backdrop and several layers of painted translucent front curtains. I remember those dioramas. Yes. Think about, like, in a peephole, you have like a painting like set, and then you have like the transparencies that kind of create like this three-dimensional effect. Really cool. Really, really cool.
De Guerre used a camera obscura for the diorama, but he sought a more efficient and effective procedure. Through a manual acquaintance, he met Joseph Nicéphore something, 1765 to 1833, who in 1826 had successfully made a permanent picture of the cityscape outside his upper story window by exposing in a camera obscura a metal plate covered with a light-sensitive coating. This fella, Joseph, his process, however, had the significant drawback that it required an 8-hour exposure time. After Joseph died in 1833, De Guerre continued his work, making two important discoveries. Latent development, that is, bringing out the image through treatment and chemical solutions, considerably shortened the length of time needed for exposure. De Guerre also discovered a better way to fix the image by chemically stopping the action of light on a photographic plate, which otherwise would continue to darken until the image turned solid black. Wow, crazy. The daguerreotype reigned supreme in photography until the 1850s, but the second major photographic invention, the ancestor of the modern negative print system, eventually replaced it. On January 31st, 1839, less than 3 weeks after De Guerre unveiled his method in Paris, W.H.F. Falbot presented a paper on his photographic drawings to the Royal Institution in London. As early as 1835, Talbot made negative images by placing objects on sensitized paper and exposing the arrangement to light. This created a design of light-colored silhouettes, recording the places where opaque or translucent objects had blocked the light from darkening the paper's emulsion. In his experiments, Talbot next exposed sensitized papers inside simple cameras and, with a second sheet, created positive images. He further improved the process with more light-sensitive chemicals and a chemical development of the negative images. This technique allowed multiple prints. However, in Talbot's process, which he named the callotype from the Greek kalos, beautiful, the photographic images incorporated the texture of the paper. This produced a slightly blurred, grainy effect, very different from the crisp detail and wide tonal range available with the daguerreotype. Also, discouraging widespread adoption of the callotype were the stiff licensing and equipment fees charged for many years after Talbot presented his new process in 1841. An earlier master of an improved kind of callotype photography was the multi-talented Frenchman Nader. He used glass negatives and albumen printing paper prepared with egg white, cool, which could record finer detail and wider range of light and shadow than Talbot's callotype process. The new wet plate technology, also named because the photographic plate was exposed, developed, and fixed while wet, cool, almost at once became the universal way of making negatives until 1880. However, wet plate photography had drawbacks. The back plates had to be prepared. Oh, this is the wet plate photography. Let me show you that picture real quick. Where is it? I mean, it's pretty morbid, but it's a wet plate. So it had its drawbacks. The plates had to be prepared and processed on the spot.
Working outdoors meant taking along a portable darkroom of sorts, a wagon, tent, or box with light, tight sleeves for the photographer's arms. Oh, I like that. Cognitive Resonance said, "Daguerreotypes are rare and difficult to restore. Where did you get that? It's really stark." Where did I get what? So, oop. Where did that go? Yeah. Okay, so let's get to Nader. Making portraits was an important economic opportunity for most photographers, and portraiture quickly became one of the most popular early photographic genres. The greatest of the early portrait photographers was Gaspar Felix Tornikon, known simply as Nader, 1828 to 1910. A French novelist, journalist, and caricaturist, photographic studies for his characters led Nader to open a portrait studio. So talented was he at capturing the essence of his subjects that the most important people in France, including Delacroix, Daumier, Courbet, and Manet, flocked to his studio to have their portraits made. Nader said he saw in his work that instant of understanding that puts you in touch with the model, helps you sum him up, guides you to his habits, his ideas, and character, and enables you to produce a really convincing and sympathetic likeness and intimate portrait. I agree, Nader, because I actually do portrait photography myself. And I'm going to read that again. Nader said that he saw in his work that instant of understanding that puts you in touch with the model, helps you sum him up, guides you to his habits, his ideas, and character, and enables you to produce a really convincing and sympathetic likeness, an intimate portrait. Nader's Eugene Delacroix. Oh, wait. 12-1. Is this 12-1? What the hell is 12-1? Oh, it's in the beginning of the chapter. Right? No. 12-1. Oh, no. Are we in the wrong chapter? Hold up. Please don't tell me I labeled this stream wrong. I have to update the thumbnail. My fucking god. I cannot believe it. Got the wrong dates. We're doing Europe 1800 to 1870. Not 1870 to 1900. Fucking god. Ridiculous. I can't get anything right. Let's bring you to here. Here we go. Is this Nader? It's a bit distorted, I feel like. Yeah, look at him. So, Eugene Delacroix, circa Delacroix, circa 1855. It's a modern print, 8.5 inches by 6 2/3 inches from the original negative. Cool. Eugene Delacroix, the great romantic painter, we saw him earlier in the chapters, was one of many 19th century artists intrigued by how photography presented reality. Here he sat for Nader, one of the earliest portrait photographers. What a cool portrait. Let me fix the way it looks for you because it's really cool. Why isn't this working? Oh. There we go. That's more like it, like that. What a lovely portrait. I love it. Men, you guys gotta start taking, first of all, that, like, collar is fucking dope, okay? His hair, great. The dignified look, not directly at the camera, but turning away. The hand in the jacket, really dope. I like that in there. Yeah, man. Cool. Very dignified. Jack, I'm going to take a portrait of you like that. He's probably not even watching anymore. Really annoyed that I have the wrong dates on this stream. Really annoyed right now. Wrong chapter. And it was the wrong picture. I was showing you a picture of this other guy, not Nader. But that, to be fair, that was like a type of, I think it was the wet photography. Yeah. Let's just get back to this. So, yeah, so it's showing the painter at the height of his career. In this photograph, the artist imparts remarkable presence. Indeed, he does. Even in half length, his gesture and expression create a mood that reveals much about him. Perhaps Delacroix responded to Nader's famous gift for putting his clients at ease by assuming the pose that best expressed his personality. The new calotype photography process made possible the rich range of tones in Nader's images. Yeah, man, let's look at that again real quick. I mean, I love it. Dope. So this is the calotype photography, so I had, like, negative. Really dope. Do I ever do pinhole cameras? Yeah, I mean, no. But I would like to. I've for some reason become really fond of photography, and as a photographer myself, and I love all of the things. And when I was a model performer, and more of a performer in New York City, and modeling as like art modeling kind of came hand in hand with that. I was never really into like the whole like model thing, like industry. But I would just model as like a secondhand kind of thing with being a performer and in being in the arts scene in New York. So I did modeling for like artists, and we would do, like I said, film photographs, the Polaroids, the Hasselblads, like the old, I don't know if it's Polaroid, but where you had to rip the black off of the seal off of it. A lot of different camera types and things. And so I don't know, I got into it as the model aspect. It was super fun, and I see why it was an enjoyment for the photographers as it was for me too. I like the artistry of it, not just like taking a pretty picture. So it was really fun for us, but now I'm kind of on the other end. I do my own self-portraits, but it can be difficult. Like, for example, the vintage cameras and stuff. I don't have that remote shutter that I use with my Nikon. But I would love to try the pinhole cameras, all of these things that they're talking about. I'm kind of like, ooh, cool. Like, I want to own all of these things and try all of the processes of this photography out. It would be really cool. And if anyone ever comes to New York, hit me up. We can experiment and do some really cool photography. All right, let's finish this up. Okay, so the last one, we have this O'Sullivan guy. Let's switch this up. Yeah, we're back to this picture. So this is Timothy O'Sullivan, A Harvest of Death, Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. Here we come to America. July 1863. It's a negative by Timothy O'Sullivan. Original print by Alexander Gardner. It's 6 3/4 inches by 8 3/4 inches. And it's at the New York Public Library. Oh, wow, I can see this one myself. Astor Lenox and Tilden Foundations. Rare Books and Manuscripts Division, New York. Very cool. I went to a Rare Books and Manuscripts Fair in New York. And that's where I saw and held the actual Mutis Libra, which is exciting. So this is a wet plate technology enabled photographers to record historical events on the spot and to comment on the high price of war, as in this photography of death, Union soldiers at Gettysburg in 1863. Photographers were quick to realize the documentary power of their new medium. Thus began the story of photography's influence on modern life and of the immense challenges it brought to communication and information management. Historical events could be recorded in permanent form on the spot for the first time. I mean, yeah. Usually this kind of picture would be depicted in a painting to, you know, say something. But for the first time we can get actual pictures, which is crazy. The photographs taken of the Crimean War, 1856, and of the American Civil War remain unsurpassed as incisive accounts of military life, unsparing in their truthful detail and poignant as expressions of human experience. Yeah, that's exactly kind of what I thought and didn't have the words. It's unsparing in their truthful detail. Like, that is crazy to have a photograph of something like that, of war. Of the Civil War photographs, the most moving are the inhumanly objective records of combat deaths. Perhaps the most reproduced is Harvest of Death, Gettysburg, July 1863, this figure that we're looking at, by Timothy O'Sullivan, 1840 to 1882. Although viewers could regard this image as simple news reportage, it also functions to impress on people the high price of the Civil War. Corpses litter the battlefield as far as the eye can see. As the photograph modulates from the precise clarity of the bodies of Union soldiers in the foreground, boots stolen and pockets picked, to the almost indistinguishable corpses in the distance. Let me just have a look at it real quick. Yeah. Okay. Let me catch up to you guys here. So yeah, the bodies in the background. Oh, I see on horses too. Someone in a horse in the background. Wow. Crazy. Wild. Okay, so the Union soldiers in the foreground, boots stolen and pockets picked, to the almost indistinguishable corpses in the distance. The suggestion of innumerable other dead soldiers is unavoidable. This harvest is far more sobering and depressing than that in Winslow Homer's Civil War painting, Veteran in a New Field. Though it was years before photolithography, could reproduce photographs like this in newspaper, photographers exhibited them publicly. These images made an impression that news printing engravings never could. Crazy. Okay, well, that is the end of the chapter that I had wrong. I'm going to have to update that thumbnail now. I'm really annoyed. Let's check in on you guys here. As depressing as it is, it's a beautiful photo. Not a fan of death, but I can appreciate the art of it. Yeah, I mean, it is really interesting. This is like the stuff you saw on Rotten. That's true. It's true. The fact that it's black and white makes it more haunting, too. Agree. Those are probably only some of the bodies. I imagine there were probably a lot more. And those guys in the background are probably army guys. Imagine what the camera was thinking. Sorry, imagine what the cameraman was thinking. Yeah. Yeah. It's wild. Probably not much. This was Gettysburg. The war wasn't new at this point. Weird how war pics and footage nowadays are mainstream. Yeah, I mean, I was even thinking about the picture, you know, like there's the famous one, it's black and white, and there's like a woman holding like a child, and she's like this or something, and there's a bunch of photographs that, I mean, photojournalism is really interesting and really artistic in its own right, for sure. I mean, correct me if I'm wrong. I'm sure there are some that have amazing photographs today as well and capture something great. But I feel like a lot of the stuff that I see is less artistic photojournalism and more of like just snapping a picture. I mean, they'll grab things off of an iPhone footage. Just everyone's kind of shitty iPhone. Not that like iPhone takes shitty quality, because it can be good quality, but it's like back then, for a photographer, like, they really had the artistry, and now you have everybody having a camera, like, on them at all times. Not everyone has that artistic eye, so it's like, they'll just snap a picture, and it all looks kind of really generic and the same. And, I mean, sure, we capture things, and there's cameras all the time to be able to capture things, and that's amazing for news, and for us as news consumers, but I just kind of miss the artistry of some of these important historical things that, you know, we can depict with these photographers. I miss it. I don't know. Being in New York, yeah, I'd love to, and I've done it in the past, and I have some amazing photographs, actually, from the Paris riots that I could show. Yeah. Yeah, Wise Guys Entertainment said, I may be showing my some ignorance, but one of my concerns about using the old photography cameras is finding someone who still can develop that kind of film, unless you set up your own darkroom, I guess. Yeah, I mean, I would be interested in doing the darkroom stuff myself as well. I mean, they had us doing it in high school, so, like, I don't see why, like, in my 30s I can't figure that out. High school kids could do it in the 2000s. Why not? But you'd be surprised, being in New York. I mean, this is where art. I mean, this is where Andy Warhol was. This is where the artist, a weirdo artist of artists, are and creating. So we have some amazing photography things and resources. So I'm pretty sure I can do anything I want in New York, which is pretty amazing, but yeah, having the most control possible would be ideal. There is a place in Silver Spring where you can develop your own film and have a coffee. That sounds awesome. Yeah. Cool. All right, guys. Well, it was a blast. Thank you for staying with me and getting this stream back going. Sorry for the frustration. I You know, I really hate technology. I don't know how to do this stuff. I really wish I could just have someone handle it for me, but I think just being away from it for so long, it's difficult to come back, but we'll get there. We'll get there. So with that, I will probably put on the other commercial if you want, and I'll hang around in the chat unless there's any last comments, questions, super chats. Just let me know. Is there anyone even close to Andy Warhol nowadays? I can't think of any. Yeah, you know, it's interesting because in the 2010s, early 2010s, I was thinking about that and I was like, well, listen, in history books, there's always some sort of great artist at some time period, at any point. And I was like, well, there's got to be artists in New York today that will be in the history books. Who are they? We don't know who they are now, but in years to come, they're going to be in history books. And this is New York, man. Where are these? Who are these artists? So thank you, BMT Lines. Thank you so much. And I was looking them up, and it's funny, I became friends with a few of them. I have one book. It's like this big, giant art history type book. A friend of mine, Mark Kostabi, I became friends with him after looking things up like that. And he has in Chelsea a studio with apprentices and all that stuff. And yeah, he did sculptures for the Pope. I mean, he's a legit artist. He's not like Warhol, but I mean, he's a famous artist, a different kind of artwork for sure. And then I met another one, Robert Lazzarini. I looked him up and I was like, who are the artists of today? And he does, like, I guess you'd say sculptures. He was one of the first that I've ever met. Back before it was like anyone can buy a 3D printer, it was like a big giant. It's like a 50s computer. And like no one had this technology, but he was 3D printing things, and he would create weird like sheer, like mathematical sheer. So he did math and art, kind of like I like. And he did some shearing of real life objects that when you create like a telephone, like old fashioned telephone or something, and you put like a mathematical shear on it where it looks like it's all distorted, and then you reproduce it, it has this weird psychological effect. And he would do like set design and things like that, and just weird. He also had a factory and apprentices and things like that. There are artists. They are amazing. They do different stuff. I mean, you can't recreate a time period and an energy that there was. I was watching a Warhol thing recently, and it's wild, because I actually do know some people in that world, that same connected world, same people that are still around today in the nightlife scene of New York. And that was my world. And it was just, it was a time before me, but in the 2000s and 2010s, there was still things going on, and it was its own unique time period of stuff and club kids and all sorts of stuff. It was really fun. And the art scene, like I said, meeting these people, Lazzarini, whatever, there's people. They're around, art is happening, people are making things. You may not know who they are right now, today, but they're there. It's really fun. Hello, Spencer. Sorry, but we're out of here. It's the end of the stream. You can go rewind and check back, but I'm going to go put a commercial on, and I'll be in the chat. So thank you guys for sticking around. It really means a lot. All right, love you guys. Bye.
You got a date, skin's looking great, cause Clearasil's ace. Face to face. See you at eight, skin's looking great, CJ's the place. Face to face.
Clearasil gives you great looking skin, even close up. Inside, it kills bacteria to dry the pimple.
Clearasil's ace, face to face.
Outside, it soaks up all the excess oil.
Feeling first great, your skin's looking great, cause Clearasil's ace.
Clearasil, for skin that looks great, even close up.
Face to face.
Improved styling constantly adds to the ease and grace and gaiety of American living. The things we have in America are ever changing. The studios and workshops of our stylists pour forth a never-ending flow of service and of artistry. Lines, planes, forms, and substances in colors. On come the developments of ideas, in pace with the emphatic decisions of the American people as to what they want, in the shapes of utility, and in the manner of their own ever-improving good taste. For our home life, the stylists are creating new expressions of utility, convenience, and beauty in the everyday things that serve us. Wondrous possessions which have new grace and glamour are offered the American people. New plans. They have new patterns for living, made attractive by luxurious interiors. Living space is enhanced by new materials and accented by subtleties of color selection. Look as well as the way they perform. Our homes acquire new grace, new glamour, new accommodations, expressing not only the American love of beauty, but also the basic freedom of the American people, which is the freedom of individual choice.